HarperCollins presents The Life Sentence by Jackie Kabler. Read by Sofia Engstrand. For Michal Murphy. Buff. 1. Heather. You don't expect your life to change in a bookshop. Books may be among the best things in the world, and maybe reading can change your life, but that's a whole other conversation. What I mean is that when you're in a bookshop listening to a talk by one of your favourite authors, you don't expect the stranger sitting beside you to effectively throw a bomb into your safe little world and blow it all to smithereens. You don't expect her to steal your handbag either. But I'm jumping ahead now, so let's start from the beginning. My name is Heather Harris, and I'm a bookseller at a gorgeous shop in Chiswick, West London. But today is Wednesday, one of my days off, so I hop on a tube to Richmond-upon-Thames, just a few miles away. I've been a fan of crime writer Lydia Cornish for years, and when I heard she was doing a talk and a signing at Words on the Street, the big high street bookstore, I knew I couldn't miss it. It's the sort of thing I often do on a day off. The sort of thing that makes my friends roll their eyes and mutter words like obsessed under their breath. Although it's all done with affection, or at least I hope so. Sometimes they follow the muttering with a helpful suggestion that I should try signing up to a dating app because I've been on my own too long now and I need to live a little. I nod and grin and make vague gestures that imply I might take up the suggestion one day soon. I won't, though. Not yet. My last proper relationship ended nearly 2 years ago and, well, let's just say it put me off a bit. Dating doesn't interest me right now. My life is full. I'm content just the way I am. But I digress. Again. So, the Lydia Cornish event. I love this bookstore. Words on the Street is probably 5 times bigger than the shop I work in, but somehow they manage to keep the atmosphere cosy, like an old library. There are squishy armchairs and a coffee bar at the back, the smell of cinnamon and caramel mingling with the scent of ink and paper so deliciously that sometimes I wonder if they actually pump it in through the air conditioning, just to create the perfect ambiance. I've spent many a happy afternoon here, browsing the shelves and sipping cappuccinos, squirreling away ideas to take back to my boss, Kui, for our little place. Anyway, today I queue up to get my book signed. Lydia is lovely, as I'd hoped she'd be. And now it's time for the talk. I'm sitting in the third row from the back, my handbag tucked under my chair, my phone still in my hand so I can take some photos for Instagram. When the woman sits down next to me, I don't pay her much attention at first. I turn to look at her as she stoops to put her own bag on the floor, and she gives me a shy smile, so I smile back. But then I see Lydia making her way across the shop floor and get distracted, snapping some pictures and then listening, fascinated, as she describes her writing process and the inspiration behind some of her best-selling novels. Engrossed as I am, though, every now and again, I find myself glancing at the woman sitting beside me because, well, there's just something odd about her, something off about the way she's behaving. For a start, she doesn't seem to be listening to Lydia at all. And even more maddeningly, she doesn't seem to be able to keep still, constantly crossing and uncrossing her legs, picking at her nails, and pulling jerkily at a loose thread on the side seam of her jeans. There's a big clock on the wall in the children's book section over to the right, a clock with a cat in the number 12 position and white mice at 3, 6, and 9, and every few minutes she stares at it, frowning, as if willing the hands to move faster. Is she just killing time, maybe? Because she's early for an appointment or something. I'm puzzled and slightly irritated. Why come to something like this if you've no interest in it? And then just sit there, fidgeting. She's a thin woman, probably about my age, early 30s, fine blonde hair pulled into a tight little bun at the back of her head. Her face is pretty, with high cheekbones and pale, freckled skin, but her expression is tight and anxious, and just sitting next to her is starting to make me feel uncomfortable. I look around, scanning the rows of seats for an empty chair, wondering if I should move. But the talk seems to be wrapping up, Lydia asking if anyone has any questions before she has to head off to another event in central London. And so I sit there, trying to concentrate, trying to focus on the conversation and not on my growing feeling of resentment towards this stranger who's definitely somewhat spoiled what should have been a very pleasant hour. She's probably just having a bad day, I tell myself, as the room erupts into applause and Lydia stands up to leave. Remember, you never know what people are going through. Be kind. I turn, intending to swallow my annoyance, and ask her if she enjoyed the talk, but she's bending down, reaching for her bag, and then standing up abruptly. Without looking at me again, she marches away, camel trench coat swinging, black leather handbag clutched under her arm. Moments later, she's disappeared into the throng of customers. I stare after her, still perplexed by her peculiar behaviour, then sigh and pick up my own bag. It's nearly 4 o'clock, and if I hang around too much longer, I'll get caught up in the evening rush hour. So I leave the store and hurry to the tube station, the sky a stony grey on this early March afternoon, the threat of rain hanging in the damp air. As I approach the entrance, I reach into my bag for my wallet, and... what the? I splutter the words out loud as I slip the black leather strap from my shoulder and stare at my bag. It looks like my bag. It is my bag. Or is it? It's the same make, the same colour, the same style. But this bag looks newer than mine somehow. And the contents? The contents are definitely not mine. My precious signed copy of Lydia Cornish's new book isn't there for a start. Nor is my wallet, or my house keys, or my makeup bag. Instead, there's a wadge of crumpled tissue paper, two apples, and a piece of white card with something written on it. I pull it out and stare at it. There are 13 words, followed by a mobile phone number. If you want your bag and all your stuff back, call me. Now. 2. Heather. Thankfully, my phone is still in my coat pocket, where I'd shoved it as I left words on the street. I move away from the tube station entrance as a man pushing a buggy containing a small crying child rushes past me, glaring and tutting at me for daring to block his path. I realise my heart is pounding and the hand clutching the phone trembles a little, although my predominant emotion is anger. What the hell is going on? It's that bloody woman who sat next to me. It must be, I think furiously, as I tap in the phone number from the card and wait for the call to connect. Who else could have taken my bag, swapped my bag, for an almost identical one? It was with me the whole time until I put it under my seat for the talk. But why on earth? And now I have to call her to get my own bag back. This is ridiculous. Hello? The voice is female. Quiet. Nervous. What's going on? Have you stolen my bag? What's wrong with you? I spit the words into the phone more loudly than I intended, and an elderly woman who's just emerged from the station looks at me with a startled expression and walks away with impressive speed, leaving a trail of lavender perfume in her wake. I'm sorry, I didn't steal it. Not really. I'm going to return it. I just needed to get your attention, and I couldn't speak to you in such a public place. I know this all sounds very weird, but can you come and meet me now? I'm in the little cafe at the far end of Lake Street. It's just around the corner from the tube station. Oh, for God's sake! I interrupt her, infuriated. This isn't just weird, it's outrageous. It's you who was sitting next to me just now, isn't it? Who are you? There's a pause, and then she speaks again, a quiver in her voice. My name's Felicity. Felicity Dixon. Please, Heather, please come and meet me. I'll explain everything, and I'll give you all your stuff back. I'm so sorry, but it'll make sense when we speak, I promise. I'm here now, in a booth at the back. Please. How do you know my name? Oh, shit. Fine. I think I know the place you mean. I'll be there in 2 minutes, okay? But this had better be good. This is fast becoming one of the most bizarre events of my life, I think, as I stomp down the road, barely apologising as I barge into people on the busy pavement, my thoughts tumbling over each other in my head. She called me Heather, so she clearly knows who I am. But how? I'm pretty sure I've never seen her before. What could she possibly want to talk to me about? And why do something so crazy? I look down at my bag, or the bag that isn't actually my bag at all, still feeling astonished. I bought it at Marks & Spencer from their Leather Essentials collection, so it wouldn't be too hard for someone to find the same one. But it seems like such an extreme length to go to, just to speak to someone. Why didn't she just message me on social media if she wanted to speak to me privately? How did she know where I'd be today? How did she know what my bag looks like in order to buy herself the same one? And how did she know I'd be carrying it with me today? It's not the only bag I have, although I have been using it almost daily for weeks now. But still. And why has it got apples in it? Unexpectedly, I find myself grinning. This is so surreal, it's becoming almost funny. This Felicity, whoever she is, had better have a good explanation, that's all I can say. I push open the cafe door. I've been here once before, and it's nice. A small, always busy deli and coffee shop, with a selection of mismatched tables and chairs and a row of booths upholstered in blue leather along one wall. I see Felicity immediately, leaning out of the booth at the very back, and raising a hand briefly in greeting before sliding back into her seat. I weave my way between the tables, dodging a waiter carrying a tray laden with teacups and what looks like slabs of carrot cake, and plonk myself down opposite her. I wriggle out of my coat and dump it on the seat beside me. Right, who are you, what do you want, and can I please have my bag back now? I say loudly, and she visibly flinches. Please, please be quiet, she hisses. I think we're okay in here, but I'm just trying to be so careful. She glances furtively around the cafe and then turns back to face me as I stare at her, feeling more confused and exasperated than ever. For goodness sake, are you going to tell me what's going on here or not? I snap, but I make an effort to lower my voice. She looks scared, I suddenly realise. And I'll have my bag now too, I add. It's sitting on the table, and I grab it and rummage through the contents. Everything's still there, my signed book, my wallet, my makeup bag, everything. I look up. Well? I say. Here's yours, by the way. Why the heck has it got apples in it? I push the other bag across the polished wood of the tabletop and see a tiny smile lift the corners of her mouth. For wait, she says. Look, let me try to explain. I needed to speak to you, okay? I'll explain why in a minute. I've been following you on Instagram for a while, your bookseller account. But I didn't want to just message you because I don't trust social media, you know? It can be hacked, and I didn't want any written proof of any communication between us. Anyway, I was going to come and visit you in Meadow Bookshop where you work, But again, I thought that might be too risky, too close to home. So I thought, no, wait till she's out somewhere on neutral ground. Then you posted about the Lydia Cornish event.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.